Cincinnati Reds baseball coming up tonight from Riverfront Stadium. Today is Thursday, August the 11th, 1983. This is DVP with my 28th game scored for this season. Tonight's matchup will feature the Reds against Tommy Lasorda's second-place Los Angeles Dodgers in the final of a three-game series. This will be Game 3 of the Reds' current nine-game homestand. After the Dodgers leave town, the Padres will come in for three ball games, and then the Houston Astros will visit Riverfront for a three-game series beginning next Monday evening. My last game scored was a Reds 5-3 victory over the Padres to close out an 11-game road trip on Sunday, August the 7th. Frank Pastore getting the victory and hitting a big home run for the game-winning RBI in that particular game as the Reds closed out the road trip a respectable 5-6. There was an off day the next day on Monday, August the 8th. The Reds came back home to Riverfront to start the nine-game homestand in the first of three against the Dodgers on August the 9th in a special starting time at 8:15 Cincinnati time. The game was telecast over the NBC network as its backup game for a special Tuesday night edition of Major League Baseball, although it was not seen in any part of the Midwest. It was blacked out in Cincinnati and surrounding areas. And the Reds had a good ball game. That was one of the best games of the season, the first of two contests. I have to recap here in my Reds recap section of the broadcast. The Reds have gone 2-0 since I last scored one on August the 7th, as the Reds have had back-to-back victories against this Los Angeles ball club. And Cincinnati has played very well against the Dodgers this season. In fact, with the win last evening, the Reds went over 500 against the Dodgers at 7 wins and 6 losses, and a lot of those have been tight, close-knit, one-run ball games, and it was no exception on Tuesday night, August the 9th. A thriller. I've got a couple of highlights coming up that I'll play off the Reds radio network in just a second after I take a look at the totals, etc. The Reds winning it 5-4 in sudden death with one out in the bottom of the ninth inning on a game-winning single by Paul Householder, his 20th RBI of the year and his first in a long time. He was starting in that ball game in center field in favor of Eddie Milner, who had a slight injury that day, and House was only 1-for-5 on the day, but that one hit a big one for the game-winning RBI, his third of the season. Danny Dreesen knocked in his 43rd run for the Reds' first run in that game. Nick Osaski had a run batted in, and Johnny Bench fractured a 2-2 tie in the bottom half of the eighth inning with a big clutch double to right center field as a pinch hitter, his fifth pinch hit of the season, and RBI's numbers 4 and 5 as a pinch swinger this season to give him 41 ribbies overall on the season. That brought the crowd of 20,473 to its feet as Bench was taken down then for a pinch runner Tom Foley, and a huge hand for Johnny as he went back into the dugout after that what appeared to be a game-winning pinch hit double, but it turned out the Dodgers came back with two outs and a runner at second base. They scored twice in the top of the ninth inning to tie it again at 4-4. It was that type of ball game at Riverfront. But you just had a feeling the Reds were going to come out on top the way they broke the tie on the bench hit in the eighth inning. They did just that with one out. Concepcion had a double and then scored minutes later on a Householder base hit to left field to give the Reds the 5-4 thrilling nationally televised victory. The Reds had 5 runs, 10 hits without an error, and left 9. The Dodgers had 4 runs with 10 hits, no errors. So a very close game, even in the hit column. The Dodgers left just 1 fewer on base than the Reds. Reds 9 left on, Dodgers 8 stranded. Mario Soto was the winning pitcher. Boy, what a pitching matchup. That was kind of a dream game, I guess you could say, for NBC's what I believe to be their first special Tuesday night edition of Major League Baseball. And of course, normally Vin Scully and Joe Garagiola on the air on NBC on Saturday afternoons. But they do a Tuesday ball game here as it's getting down to the dog days of August and September. And they wanted to televise the Dodgers, who are in the thick of things, although now 6.5 back and in second place in the National League West, having dropped some 3 straight. And I guess it was sort of a dream game, a supreme pitching matchup, and the great thrilling antics by the Reds in the last couple of innings, getting 3 runs to pull it out. Mario Soto going for Cincinnati against left-hander Fernando Valenzuela, the 22-year-old Mexican southpaw, who went 7 2/3 and struggled. He gave up 8 hits and 4 runs all earned. He walked 5, but 3 of those were deliberate. He struck out 5 batters. He is still 3-2 lifetime against the Reds and has had 3 games and a complete game win against Cincinnati this season. His ERA jumped 20 points lifetime versus Cincinnati As I have figured that out, he has been in 11 games, 9 starts against the Reds, with a 303 earned run average covering all of his games versus the Reds. And then Tom Niedenfuhr came on for 1/3, and then Steve Howe, a third of an inning, 2 hits, and the big run given up in the 9th. He's the loser. He is 4-6 now, and Soto went all the way. It looked like Nixon might take him out after he gave up the 2 runs with 2 out on the top of the 9th, and the game tying hit there to make it 4-4 was on a bloop single that just barely made it into the outfield. But Soto did weather the storm and got the final out, so it is a complete game for Mario. And that is his 13th complete game of the year, most in the majors. He's second in the National League in wins, still has the chance of winning 20. If he can win 20, it'll be the first Reds 20-game winner since 1970, when Jim Merritt won exactly that many. Tom Seaver won 21 in 1977, but only 14 of those came after he was traded over to the Reds from the New York Mets. Mario just having an unbelievably good season, and we talked about his great season last year. This one is even better. A 13 complete games to go with a 13-9 record, and now a 248 earned run average, as I'll have a look at his seasonal numbers now. He's been in 24 games, has completed over half of those, 13, and has 2 shutouts, both of those coming in May. He has allowed a lot of home runs, but that's to be expected with that hard fastball he throws. He's given up 18, and some to some unlikely candidates to hit long balls, especially 3 he's given up to the Dodgers this year in a 1-0 June 17th L.A. victory at Dodgers Stadium. Bobby Welch took him deep, and he, of course, is a pitcher. That was for the game winner and the only run of that game. And last night, or 2 nights ago, in that start for Soto, he allowed a home run to Jack Fimple, the young catcher for the Dodgers, his first major league homer, and Steve Sachs also took him deep. That's his 5th of the year, a solo shot there. So he's allowed 18 home runs now. He allowed only 19 all of last year to lead the team. In 195 and 2/3 innings, and of course that tops the team, he's allowed only 148 hits. 64 runs, 10 unearned. He has walked only 67. That's just barely a 3 per 9 innings, and is averaging over 8 strikeouts every complete game. 176 strikeouts. That is second in the major leagues next to who else? Steve Carlton. It's those two guys again running neck and neck for the strikeout derby like last season. Last night, on Tuesday, he did struggle somewhat, but to show you what kind of pitcher he is, he still waded through and got the complete game. He allowed 4 runs, 4 earned runs, 2 homers, 10 hits in 9 innings with 3 walks and 6 strikeouts. So 13th victory for Mario Soto. What an amazing pitcher he has been. The time was 2 hours and 51 minutes on Tuesday, and the attendance 20473. No home runs for Cincinnati. Nick Osaski had a stolen base, his 5th of the season. And coming up, I'll play the 2 big hits in that ball game as they replayed them on the Reds Radio Network off of WLW on Tuesday night. A big hit for Johnny Bench, and then the game-winning safety by Paul Householder as the Reds pull it out 5-4.
Outfield deep and playing him to pull. Runners leading at first and second base. There's a line drive. The count on Householder in the pitch. Swung on, base hit left field. Here comes Concepcion. Mundy drops the ball, and this one belongs to the Reds. Paul Householder with a line drive, base hit to left field. Mundy charged. He dropped it, and at that point, it was all over but the proverbial shouting. Paul Householder coming through with a game-winning base hit as the Reds win it in the bottom of the ninth inning. Final
Well, that was the big game-winning base hit 2 nights ago on August the 9th by Paul Householder to give the Reds the 5-4 win over the Dodgers to open up this series in a big way, and it opened up a 9-game homestand. What you just heard, that run Householder drove in, that's his first RBI since June the 30th when he knocked in 4 in a 15-5 victory over the San Francisco Giants at Riverfront Stadium. So that's a long time between RBIs, between June 30 and August 9, and finally Householder gets another ribby, and it was a big one. Okay, now let's take a look at last night's bowl game. Wednesday, August the 10th, a 7:35 start. The Reds, well, they brought out some big bats and easily getting by the Dodgers, and this is a rare, easy time of it for the Reds against L.A. this season. Normally, we'll have those bowl games like we had Tuesday. Those tight frog stranglers. A 9-2 final last night. The Reds had 9 runs, 12 hits with no errors. The Dodgers had two runs on just five hits with two errors. Bruce Bereni went all the way for Cincinnati. He gets his sixth win in his third complete game. That is the third straight Reds complete game. Over the Padres on Sunday by Pastore, over the Dodgers Tuesday by Soto, and over the Dodgers Wednesday as Bereni goes the distance with a five-hitter, gave up just two runs, walked seven, but he also struck out seven in that game. No homers allowed. The only home run was hit by Danny Bilardello for Cincinnati, and against his former organization. Has to be a big thrill for him. That's his fourth home run of the season. They've all, ironically, come at Riverfront Stadium. His fourth homer of the year. That knocked in two of his four on the day. He knocked in four runs, his biggest day run production-wise in the major leagues. It gives him 21 RBIs. Gary Reedus, Nick Osaski, and Danny Dreesen had the other Reds' runs batted in, and one of the runs was not knocked in. Osaski had two RBIs to give him 29. Left on base in that game, Dodgers 7 and the Reds 8. Bereni's now 6-11 with that win. Bert Hooten took the loss. He's 8-6. He only went 3 1/3, gave up 6 hits and 4 runs, and all of them earned. He walked 2, no strikeouts, and then Pat Zachary, 2/3 of an inning, 1 strikeout. Joe Beckwith, 2 innings, 3 hits, 3 runs, only 1 earned, 2 walks, 2 strikeouts. And Dave Stewart, 2 runs, 1 unearned, 3 hits, 2 innings, a walk, and 1 strikeout. Game-winning RBI for Gary Reedus. He leads the team now with 8. The time was 2 hours and 31 minutes. Paid attendance, 14,685. And the total crowd last night at the stadium, 16,512. Another good day for the Reds as they go to 7-6 against the Dodgers this year. That was the third straight Cincinnati victory. And tonight, the Reds will be trying to match their longest winning streak of this year or last season, 4 straight. They only did it once last year, and that was a year ago this month. That was against the Astros, and then a 3-game sweep against the New York Mets, which culminated with an August 19th victory, a 10-inning win on a Ron Oster home run, and hopefully the Reds will be able to win 4 in a row again this season. They did it earlier in the year. In fact, 4 of the first 6 games, I believe it was, they swept the Cubs 4 in just the second series of the season. Here's the pitching line on Bruce Bereni now for the season. He's been in 23 games, 3 complete games. He has 1 shutout and has allowed 6 home runs, 6-11 with a .394 earned run average. He has struck out 115 batters, has walked 75 and 139 plus a third inning. 132 hits, 71 runs, and like Soto, he's given up exactly 10 unearned runs to this point in the season. So good series so far. The Reds assure themselves of winning this set. And with the win last night, the Reds have won as many games against the Dodgers this year as they did all of last season. And not only that, they have won as many games against, well, any team this season than they did last year. That is to say, they had no more than 7 wins against any of the 11 National League opponents in 1982. That's how bad last year was. But the Reds are 10, 11, and maybe 12 games ahead of last year's pace. And ironically, 1 year ago, last night, we were playing those Dodgers. I remember what happened, too. Fernando Valenzuela, I believe, beat us with a complete game, an 11-5 win, something like that. And I think that put the Dodgers right back into the race or into first place. Dodgers had an amazing string where they gained something like 10 games in a 10-day period. The Braves were in just a miserable slump of going 2-19. And now 1 year later, we're playing the Dodgers and we're whipping them 5-4 and now 9-2 last night behind Bruce Bereni's 5-hitter. And we were 7-11 against Los Angeles last season, and including a miserable 2-7 at Riverfront Stadium. And the Reds also won 7 against the Mets and the Astros, but they did not win 8 games against any team last season. And now we've already won 7 against, well, 2 different opponents. We finished out 7-5 against the Eastern Division New York Mets. So the Reds 2-0 in the last 2, and a 3-game winning streak on the line. The Reds are now 52-62 on the season, just 10 games under .500, and the Reds have played very good baseball since the All-Star game, with the 4th best record in the National League since that July 6th ball game at Comiskey Park, the 50th anniversary All-Star game, that is. And now it's time for August the 11th action, Reds against the Dodgers, to close out this series. Reds baseball coming up.
of inning number 9. And for Cincinnati, Gary Reedus, who has had one of the Reds' 8 base hits and has scored 2 of the Reds' 3 runs, will be the leadoff batter. That's a strikeout swinging. He has fanned 7 batters in 3 1/3 innings. Facing Dave Concepcion. Dave, he's 0 for 2. He's had a sacrifice fly. He's also drawn a walk. He takes this one way inside. The ball goes all the way back. That is a high fly ball hit into right field. Darryl Thomas is in, and he's waiting, and they're 2 gone. So Cedeno, and now we've got Concepcion going in toward the mound after Tom Niedenkure, and both dugouts empty. The Dodger dugout, the Reds dugout, and apparently Concepcion felt like Niedenkure was throwing at him. And Davey being restrained out there behind the mound. The battle lines were drawn, but now Davey walking away from it all as the players are milling around and really just fooling around. Nobody appears to be upset. And Davey will be the first one back into the dugout, but Concepcion apparently feeling that that pitch had something behind it. And he was trying to get at Niedenkure, but the umpires step in and no blows are thrown. Tommy Lasorda is upset. He's jawing out there behind the mound with Jerry Crawford, and Tommy really getting with it now with a plate umpire. Frank Pulley, Bob Davidson also there. Niedenkure staying loose by throwing down to Jack Fimple, but players going back to their respective dugouts, and Lasorda's been thrown out. Tommy and Jerry Crawford nose to nose. And I'll tell you one thing, Lasorda's giving him all he wants. He's been pitched out, and of course, after the fact, you might as well give him your best shot. They can't do anything else. Tommy won't let Crawford get away, but Tom Lasorda has been thrown out of here after we have a near fight as a result of Concepcion's apparent contention that Niedenkure was throwing at him. I'll tell you one thing. You get Dave Concepcion upset, and it doesn't make any difference who it is. If you don't believe it, ask Ron Reed. They don't get much bigger than that in the National League, and Tom Niedenkure is cut out of the same mold. He's a big guy. 2 strikes and a high pop behind the plate. It's coming back, and it'll be out of play. Here's a fly ball hit back into left, and Mundy will make the catch, and the Dodgers win it. No runs, no hits, nobody left on here in the ninth. Final score as the Dodgers avoid a sweep. L.A. 4 and the Reds 3. Well, the Reds were trying to sweep the series, and the Dodgers were trying to avoid just that. And L.A. got it going early in the first inning tonight. After Charlie Puleo retired Steve Sachs and Rick Mundy on routine ground balls, all of a sudden he lost control. He issued back-to-back walks to Kenny Landreau and Pedro Guerrero, and then Greg Brock gave the fans here at Riverfront an indication of what kind of opposite field power he has as he lined one just inside the foul screen down the left field line for his 15th home run, and the Dodgers were out in front 3-0. The Reds, of course, have shown the ability to come back, especially since the All-Star break, and they did just that tonight. Against Jerry Royce in the bottom of the first inning, Gary Reedus had a one-out single, and one out later, Cesar Cedeno lined a double into the left field corner to make it 2-1. Then followed walks to Danny Dreesen and Nick Asaski, but Royce got out of further difficulties by striking out Ron Oster to leave the bases loaded. The Reds came back in the third to tie it up. Reedus reached on an error, a throwing error by Billy Russell, and later on, stealing third base and coming home to score on a Concepcion sacrifice fly to make it 3-2. Cesar Cedeno then had a base hit to center, came up with his 11th stolen base of the season, advanced to third on an infield single by Danny Dreesen, and scored the tying run on a Jack Fimple pass ball. It stayed 3-3. The Reds had a big shot at him in that same third when they then loaded the bases again, but Royce came up with big outs as he fanned Oster for the second out and got Bill Ardello on a fly ball to left to strand 2 men on base. The Reds came back in the fourth inning, had the bases loaded with 2 out, and could not score. And then we come to the Dodgers' 7th inning, and in that inning with 1 out, our star of the game, Dave Anderson, had the base hit to right. The Dodgers played run and hit. Sachs had a base hit to right field, moving the rookie Anderson to third. And after Rick Mundy got a walk to load him up,
Charlie Puleo was lifted in favor of left-hander Billy Shear. Ken Landreau hit the first pitch he threw into right field for a sacrifice fly. Anderson scored, and it was 4-3 Los Angeles. The one shot that the Reds had against a right-hander Tom Niedenfuhr came in the eighth inning with one down. Dwayne Walker came off the bench and had a base hit into right field. He stole second base as pinch hitter Johnny Bench struck out, but stayed there when Niedenfuhr fanned Eddie Milner on three pitches. The Reds went out in order, 1-2-3 in the ninth inning, and the Dodgers came up with a one-run victory, their 22nd of the year against 15 such defeats. L.A. had four runs, five hits, an error, leaving six. The Reds had three runs, eight hits, no errors, and left 10. Niedenfuhr pitching four innings of one-hit baseball with seven strikeouts, goes 6-1 with a victory, and Puleo goes 4-8 with the loss. Tomorrow night, the Reds against a new opponent. This time, it'll be the San Diego Padres of manager Dick Williams, a 7:35 starting time. And again, the reminder, tomorrow night is family night. Bargain prices for families coming out to the ballpark tonight, and we've got plenty of seats available as Frank Pastore tries to beat the San Diego club for the second time in 5 days. He went all the way last Sunday at Jack Murphy Stadium. He'll hook up with right-hander Eric Schell. We'll have the pregame shows tomorrow night on most of these same stations, beginning at 7:05 Cincinnati time. Again, the final score tonight, a game that took 2 hours and 52 minutes to play before a crowd of 14,069. The Dodgers 4 and the Reds 3.
That was Marty Brenneman with scores and comments on August the 11th. Reds losing to Los Angeles, a one-run decision. The Dodgers were out-hit by three. The Reds getting eight hits to the Dodgers five. But the Reds lose it by one run. Great relief pitching, as Marty pointed out, by right-hander Tom Niedenfuhr, who goes the final four innings to get the victory. That's his sixth win. Jerry Royce started for the Dodgers. He did go enough to get the win, but the game was tied when he left the mound, and so the reliever Niedenfuhr gets the win. And Royce was looking to break a seven-game losing streak tonight, but he could not do it, so that is still intact, a seven-game losing streak that is the longest in the National League this year, tied with a couple of other pitchers, including Frank Pastore of the Reds, who has pitched very well at 3-2 since the All-Star game, and he'll be going tomorrow night in the first of a three-game series against Dick Williams' Padres, and then three against the Astros to close out the nine-game homestand. This was my 28th game scored for the year, and I'll have a look at my records. It's now a .500 winning percentage exactly at 14 wins, 14 losses, including 5 wins, 3 losses since the All-Star game, and 1-1 here in the month of August. Against the Dodgers, I've scored 3, and all have been Dodger victories, including 2 at Dodger Stadium and 0-1 at Riverfront against them. At home now, 6-5, and against the West, 7-8. My record in one-run games slips to 5 wins and 3 losses. This is Lifetime Game number 338. It's number 331 involving the Reds. 194 Reds wins I have scored. 137 losses have been penciled in. That is a .586 winning percentage. 57 games over .500. In games on cassette, 127 of 224 have been victories, and therefore 97 have been losses. That's 30 over for a .567 winning percentage. The Reds have now lost 3 of my last 4 scored. I was trying to stretch it to 2 straight wins. Tonight could not do it. I snapped a 2-game losing streak, my longest in a while, in my last game on Sunday. I had a 6-game winning streak stopped a few games back, so the Reds have still won 7 of my last 10, 8 of 13, and have gone 9-7 in the last 16. Still a good record of 5-3 since that All-Star game. And now 9-9 in games under the lights this season. So that's a look at my update for 28 games here in the 83 baseball season. Have a look at the lineups now for the visiting Los Angeles Dodgers. Steve Sachs led off at second base. We'll see what he was doing through August the 10th. A .278 batting average coming into this one with 5 home runs, his 5th coming against Soto on Tuesday night in that exciting 5-4 Reds victory. So .278, pretty good year for Steve Sachs, the 1982 National League Rookie of the Year. That is the 4th consecutive Dodger Rookie of the Year. That string started in 1979 with right-handed pitcher Rick Sutcliffe winning the top rookie honor for National League, pitchers and players altogether. He was the rookie pitcher and the rookie player because he won the Baseball Writers Rookie of the Year Award, Rick Sutcliffe, as he was 17-10 in 79. And then in 1980, it was Steve Howell. In 81, of course, Fernando Valenzuela. And in 82, Steve Sachs. A potential 5th consecutive Dodger Rookie of the Year is Greg Brock, but he has really slumped off. Only .219 batting average, but he does have some pretty good statistics in other categories. And, well, to tell you the truth, if he were a member of the last-place Reds, he would be first in homers by one and first in RBIs by two. And, of course, the batting average is very low, and he's had some problems at first, but has played it fairly adequately in filling in for Steve Garvey. And this is the first year since, 1968 or 69, that Garvey has not been a Dodger. He came up, I think, in 69 and started playing regularly at third base in 1971, and now Garvey with the Padres, and he's not playing now. He's on the disabled list, had that streak of 1,207 straight games stopped on July the 29th at home against the Atlanta Braves in the first of two, and now Greg Brock doing a fairly good job in taking Garvey's place. And up until the All-Star game, you would have to say he was the top candidate, he and possibly pitcher Craig McMurtry of Atlanta, for Rookie of the Year honors this season, but you don't know what's down the road. You might want to throw in Gary Reedus of the Reds, although he has slacked off since July, has not hit a home run since the 2nd of last month, when he hit his 3rd in 3 days and his 13th of the year at Atlanta. And he has really slumped off, only about a .190 batting average since hitting that last homer. Well, let's see. Steve Sax at second. He's got a brother, Dave Sax, now on the Dodger Ball Club. Dave, as a catcher, was brought up from AAA to replace Steve Yeager when they sent down Gilberto Reyes, also another young catcher. They've had some catching problems. Jack Fimple, a newcomer, has been doing the bulk of the catching, but Mike Socha hurt, and also Steve Yeager recently was put on the disabled list. So they're going, I guess, with Fimple and Sax, and I guess an emergency third stringer would be Jose Morales, who's rarely used, and also Daryl Thomas has done some catching. Batting second in left field tonight, a Reds killer, Rick Mundy, a left-handed batter. He's had a lot of homers against Cincinnati since the 80s began. He's had 6 homers this season. He's knocked in 14, a .252 overall batting average for Rick Mundy, utilized a lot as a pinch hitter also, but has been getting quite a bit of playing time against some right-handers. Now that the Dodgers have slumped off, Mundy has been getting some playing time. L.A. snapped a 3-game losing streak with this win tonight. They have not played good ball at all since the All-Star game, going 15-19 since the break. That is next to last in National League standings, July 8th through today. Hitting third and center field is Kenny Landreau, former American leaguer, a .299 batting average, and that tops the ball club among players in this lineup tonight. .299, 13 homers and 46 runs knocked in. Hitting fourth at third base is their big man, Pedro Guerrero. Tops the team in homers, RBIs, and up there in batting average, .287. 21 homers, he's knocked in 70. Hitting fifth at first base, I mentioned him before, Greg Brock, the rookie, .219 average, 14 homers, and 46 runs batted in. Hitting sixth in right field is a second-year player. He was up part of last year and part of 81, also late. Mike Marshall, not qualified as a rookie this season. That is Mike Marshall, .283 average, 11 homers, 9 doubles, 37 runs batted in. He's having a pretty decent season. He can play third base, first base, and all over the outfield. A versatile guy and a big right-handed power plant with the same name of another ex-Dodger and former relief pitcher Mike Marshall, who signed a minor league contract recently with the Angels, and I think it was released. Hitting seventh at shortstop is Billy Russell, a .266 batting average for him with 1 home run. That was a game-winning blast off Ben Hayes in mid-June at Riverfront Stadium. Just did make it over the left center field fence for his first homer of the year and the only one he's hit. Hitting eighth is the catcher Jack Fimple. That is F-I-M-P-L-E. He came out of the Indians organization to become a Dodger in December of 82, and that was in a multiplayer deal. The Dodgers got Fimple along with Larry White. No, I think that was a 1981 deal, come to think of it. Yes, it was. That was before the 82 season. The Dodgers got 3 players, if I remember correctly. They got Jack Fimple, along with Larry White, a right-handed pitcher who was on the Dodgers' 40-man roster last season, and also George Orta in that deal, and that was in a 5-player transaction that sent the 79 Rookie of the Year that I mentioned before, Rick Sutcliffe, to the Indians, along with second baseman Jack Percanti. And now Fimple gets his first call-up, and he's had all of his RBIs and his 1 home run to this point against Cincinnati. .257 average, a homer, and 4 runs batted in. And batting ninth, the pitcher, Jerry Royce, starting out this day with a .335 ERA and 145 innings with a 7-game losing spell. He has not pitched since May or July the 30th. He missed his last turn, which was to be against the Reds at Dodger Stadium last week. He missed it because of arm injuries. He's been suffering on and off with that. But he's back in the rotation now. He has two complete games, and he was having a fairly good record, a fairly good season up until June. Did not win a single game in June and did not win any games in July, and now he's going to go half this month without a victory. A long time between wins. He was at one time 6-3 with a good ERA, but now 6-10 for Jerry Royce. In his last game at San Francisco on July the 30th, he lost an 8-0 decision, only going into the third, pitching 2+, giving up 7 hits and a home run. 7 runs, 6 earned, 3 strikeouts, no walks. The home run was hit by Bob Brindley. Against the Reds, this is his second start and second appearance this season. Now for the Cincinnati Reds, Eddie Milner leads off in center field. Milner's really been a hot hitter since moving into that leadoff spot. I think Marty said he's batting .386 since going into that leadoff post, and one hit today in 5 trips, and stretched a modest hitting streak to 4, starting out the day at .272 with 7 home runs. New career high for Eddie. Of course, he's only been with the team for, 2-plus seasons, actually part of 4 years, 80, 81, 82, and now his second full year with the team. And one of my favorite players is a fun one to watch in the outfield, one of the best center fielders I've seen, Eddie Milner, and he's knocked in, 27 runs this season. Not bad production for him. And hitting second in left field is Gary Reedus. Reedus dropped to the number 2 position. He has been hitting all over the place. He's been batting 6th, he batted 4th one time, 3rd, and now he's in the 2nd position. Seems to be picking up a little bit with the bat since Ted Kluszewski has been working with him the last couple of days. And he had a 3-for-3 ball game yesterday. Also a sac fly, I believe, and a base on balls. And he was 4 for his last 4, and had produced in 6 straight plate appearances in some fashion through the first inning and his first time up in this ball game. So a fairly good streak for Reedus, and hopefully he'll keep that up the rest of the year. He was such a hot hitter right after that injury that kept him out for 2 weeks and 6 days. He came back in early May to hit 2 home runs against Dick Ruthven, then with the Phillies, who's now with the Cubs. And that was a big blow for Reedus, and he's only hit a handful of homers really since that time, and as I mentioned, none since July the 2nd. 13 homers, that still, though, is good enough for first on the team by a couple. That's 4 away from last year's top total of 17 hit by Danny Dreesen. The Reds are now just 6 shy of last year's home run total altogether. And Reedus has 30-some runs batted in, let me see here, 35 RBIs for Gary. Hitting third at shortstop is Dave Concepcion. He's been fairly consistent over the last month. He has dropped off the last few days, though, down to .237. He did get that average up to close to .250, I think. He's got 92 hits on the year, Davey. He's had 1 home run, the only grand slam hit by a Red this season at Chicago, and he's knocked in 31 runs. Hitting fourth in right field today is Cesar Cedeño. Yeah, penciled in that number 4 position, a rarity this season. Usually Dreesen is there, but Cedeño gets in the cleanup spot tonight, and batting at .230 is all, with 7 home runs and 33 RBIs. Batting 5th at first base is Danny Dreesen. A 5-game hitting streak, a .293 batting average to top the team, 11 home runs, and a club-leading figure of RBIs, 44, so a good year shaping up for Danny. Hitting 6th at third base is rookie Nick Osaski. He's got a .271 batting average, and like Dreesen, a 5-game hitting binge. He's had already 8 home runs since being brought up a couple of months ago from Indianapolis, and he was playing his first he played his first major league game against this ball club we're now playing, the Dodgers, and he went 0-for-3 in that first game back in mid-June at Dodger Stadium after being called up a couple of days before, and he sat on the bench that Saturday game. Got into the game Sunday, and since that time has done a good job. .271, 8 homers, and 29 RBIs, including 3 game winners, and he's also picked up 5 stolen bases in as many tries. Hitting 7th at second base is Ronnie Oster. Oster batting at .272. And he's hit 9 home runs, tying last year's total of homers, a personal high for him in one season. And he's knocked in 41 runs, tied for second on the team. Hitting 8th is the catcher, Dan Belardello. Big night for him the other day, 4 RBIs to give him 21 on the year. He's knocked 4 home runs out of National League parks. Well, to be specific, out of Riverfront Stadium only. None in any road park. 4 homers for Belardello, .235 batting average. And 4 out of 5 he's hit safely in. Batting 9th is Charlie Puleo, the pitcher. He hasn't had many base hits, only 3 to be exact. All singles, 1 RBI, and .097 batting average for Charles Puleo, the former New York Met. And Paleo, as far as pitching goes, came into this game with a 4.44 earned run average and a 4-7 record and a very high total of walks. He's averaging almost 7 walks per 9 innings. That's really what's hurting this year. And also the gopher ball, he's about a dozen of those, plus one tonight. 64 walks and 95-plus innings in 18 games. This was his 16th start. And now we'll get to the action here in the top of the first inning. Well, first of all, I'll take a look at the umpires. Behind the plate was Jerry Crawford. He took some heat from Tom Lasorda in that ninth inning. I played that earlier. An altercation on the field between Davey and Tom Niedenfuhr that resulted for some reason in Lasorda being thrown out. For some reason, he was all bent out of shape every which way, and he got himself ejected. Well, he's got to get on camera once a game. So Jerry Crawford behind the plate. First base was patrolled by Frank Pulley. At second base, it was supposed to be Bob Davidson, and at third base, Jerry Dale. That's who I have penciled in here. Crawford, Pulley, B. Davidson, and Jerry Dale. But Jerry Dale was not there tonight because of an illness in his family, and before that, they thought it was an injury, a leg injury, suffered by Jerry. Apparently, he was hit by a foul ball yesterday in Game 2 of this series. They found out later there was an illness in his family, but they didn't know which it was, but anyway, Dale was not there. So working with three umpires tonight, actually Davidson was at third base or took a position between second and third on occasion, and Pulley between first and second on occasion. So actually Crawford, Pulley, and Davidson, the umpires. The game was underway about a minute late at 36 minutes past 7 Cincinnati time, and threatening weather conditions today. They had some rain earlier, but it bypassed the Cincinnati Stadium tonight, so no rain delays. A high today of 85 degrees temperature-wise, low tonight 66 on the forecast map. And thunderstorms forecast, a possibility of about 30-35%, I think, but luckily no rain. Now, we could have used it today to keep the winning streak intact because the Dodgers, of course, came out on top. The Reds have still won, though, 5 of their last 8, and have won 18 of 34 since the All-Star game. Dodgers have now lost 3 of 4 and 7 of their last 13 contests. Okay, now we can go to the top of the first inning. Let's take a look at what happened here. Charlie Puleo pitching against the Dodgers' leadoff batter Steve Sachs hit a ground ball to third base. He got into two-out problems here after Monday hit a first-pitch ground ball to shortstop. Ken Landreau started the two-out rally with a base on balls on a 3-2 pitch. Then Guerrero walked on 4 straight pitches. These walks really come back to haunt, as they have so many of the pitchers, and in particular to Puleo this season. His 66th walk of the year in just 95 and two-thirds innings, or make that 96.0, was issued to Guerrero in this first inning. So first and second, two out, and power-hitting left-handed batting first baseman Greg Brock at the plate, and he displayed his fine power to the other field. He had a line drive down the left field line that just did stay fair inside the foul pole and just did make it over the fence for a 3-run left field home run for Brock, his 15th of the year. He's had 2 of his last 3 against the Reds, and he knocks in runs number 47, number 48, and number 49 on his 15th home run. And I think that's only his third homer since June the 4th, as he went into a deep slump and they benched him and put Marshall at first and had Monday out there in the outfield. They've also got Landestoy, of course, reserve infielder outfielder, who plays on occasion and has yet to get an RBI this season. He was over 5 as a Red. But Brock with a 3-run home run, the first hit and the only hit of this inning. That is the 13th gopher ball served up by Paleo. Then Marshall struck out swinging. Paleo came back nicely to get the slugging Marshall on 3 straight pitches, the first strikeout for Charlie. 3 runs, 1 hit, a couple of key walks, no errors, nobody left on. You take away the walks, and that'd just be a solo home run, but instead we're down by 3 just like that. The Reds get one of the runs back in their half of the first inning. There was a leadoff ground ball hit by Eddie Milner, and he's an early ball hitter. He's been aggressive in that leadoff spot, and more often than not, he's been successful with that nearly 400 average since the beginning of July, I believe. Or the mid-July, anyway. Probably since the All-Star break, he's batting well over 350. A 4-3 grounder on the first pitch thrown by Jerry Royce, and then Ritas had a base hit into right center field. Dave Concepcion hit a weak ground ball to second. Sachs threw on to first baseman Brock to get Davey. Ritas went on to second base, and then Cedeno came up with a run-scoring base hit.
He lines one over third, base hit left field. That's for extra bases. Ritas will score. CC goes to second, and the Reds start the road back. It's 3-1.
So the Dodgers got a big two-out run-scoring base hit in their half of the first inning on that home run with 2 on by Greg Brock, and now the Reds do the same thing, a run-producing extra base hit with 2 men out in the inning. It's not a home run. We could have used it, but it was good enough to get a run in. A double down the left field side hit by Cesar Cedeño. And Cesar picks up a run batted in, which was his 34th of this season. He knocked in 57 last year. That was tied for first on the team. And he also led, I believe, in doubles, 35 doubles, the most he's had since, I think, 1977 with Houston. And that double for Cesar was his 14th of the year. He's one behind Bench and Oster now on the doubles list. So two-out double to left, gets a run in. That was Rita scoring from second. Moved to second on the ground ball, hit by Concepcion. Danny Dreesen then drew a base on balls on a 3-2 pitch, and then Nick Osaski did the same thing. Royce losing control here, something you don't often see him do. In fact, he entered this game averaging 1.86 walks every 9 innings. That's 30 and 145 innings flat. And that is outstanding. But he walks them back-to-back on 3-2 pitches. Dreesen and Osaski get aboard with the free passes. That loads the bases. Two down, one in. Ronnie Oster at the plate. He owns one career grand slam. That came a couple of years ago at San Francisco. This time he strikes out swinging to end the inning. So a big strikeout there for Royce to get out of the jam. A base hit of any distance there would have tied it up and possibly sent the Reds out in front. A gapper would have sent us out in front in the first inning. We get a run on two hits. There were no errors, and three runners were left on base. In the top of the second inning, the Dodgers leave the bases loaded as Paleo works out of a jam here. A leadoff single to left field by Billy Russell, and then a four-pitch walk to Jack Fimple. Already the third walk issued by Charlie in one-plus inning, and the second four-pitch pass. First and second, nobody out. Jerry Royce laid down a sacrifice on the first pitch to him. It went 1-4. Second and third for Steve Sachs. He had a pop-up in shallow right and was flagged out by Oster. So two out now. Rick Mundy draws a base on balls on a 3-2 pitch that loads them up for Kenny Landreau. On the first pitch to him, he had a foul pop to the catcher Bill Ardello to end the threat. No runs, a hit, two more walks, no errors, three runners left on base. Now on the bottom half of the second inning, the Reds go down 1-2-3. This is the most impressive inning for Mr. Royce. He gets a couple of strikeouts. Bill Ardello was caught looking at strike three, and then Puleo grounded to first base. Brock took it himself. Milner went down swinging. No runs, no hits. After two innings, it is the Dodgers 3 and the Cincinnati Reds 1. In the top of the third, it starts a string for Puleo here. He gets him in order in two straight frames. Guerrero, Brock, and Marshall, the meat of that Dodger attack. All of them capable of possibly hitting a green seater or a red seater at any time. Wouldn't be surprised to see Guerrero maybe hit one up in the upper deck at Riverfront Stadium in some future game. He's got that raw power to do it. Hit over 30 homers last season, knocked in about 100 runs, and a 300 batting average, a candidate for MVP. And this season, a candidate for MVP with those marks I mentioned before, 21 homers. And this time, he hits a ground ball 6-3, and then Brock grounds one to second, and Marshall strikes out swinging for the second time. Nothing to cross. Moving now to the latter half of the third inning, the Reds tie it up. It's the Dodgers 3 and the Reds 1 after 2.5 innings, and the Reds get a couple of runs on 3 hits against Jerry Royce in the third. To start it off, Gary Reedus reached second base on an error committed by Billy Russell. He threw one away, it got by Brock, and it went into the Reds' dugout, so a two-base throwing error on Russell. That does lead to a run. Then there was a delayed stolen base for Reedus as he made it into third base with his 30th steal of the year in 39 attempts. That leads the ball club. Then Dave Concepcion brought him in with a sacrifice fly to left field that was caught by Rick Mundy, but no play on the speedy Reedus, and it was a 3-2 Dodger lead at this point. And that is one out, one in, nobody on base now, and Cesar Cedeño with the plate. He has a single to center field. He steals a base. That is his 10th of the year in 19 attempts. He's in scoring position now for Danny Dreesen. He has an infield base hit to second base on a 3-2 pitch. That moves Cedeño to third, where he scores on a passed ball committed by Dodger rookie catcher Jack Fimple, and that ties it up at 3-all. Nick Osaski then had an infield base hit to the shortstop off of a 3-2 pitch, and that got Dreesen to third base, so again at the corners with only one out. And after this, Royce settles down. He strikes out Ronnie Oster swinging for the second time. Oster struck out three times in this game. Not a good day for him. And Bill Ardello hit a fly ball to left fielder Mundy to end this inning. We scored two times on three hits. There was one key error and two runners left on base. One of the two runs is earned and one of the two runs is unearned. And now with Joe Nuxall off the Reds Radio Network, let's plug it in with his third inning Reds action.
The 1-0, Reedus swings and bounces it up the middle. Russell is there fielding, throwing in the dirt, and it bounces through and into the Reds dugout. Reaching the ball, Jack Fimple, and he just got his tip of the catcher's mitt on it and went on into the dugout. So Reedus will move on to second. It'll be an error charge to Bill Russell. Maybe takes outside, 2-2. There goes Reedus, and he caught Thimple. Gary standing off the bag at second. When Thimple raised his arm to throw back to Royce, Gary took off, and he was in there without a play being made. The 2-2, Davies swings, and a fly ball to left field. That should get Reedus in. Mundy drifting back in left center waiting. He has it. Reedus scores and bats in with the second run of the game for the Reds. Now, Gary Reedus more or less stole the run from the Dodgers right there. He caught him napping, and but Davey, that's his 36th to make that his 32nd RBI of the year. Ball, no strikes to Cedeno. Royce winds the pitch, and it's swung on, and he's 2-for-2 as he sends it into center field. Royce ready with the 3-1. There goes Cedeno. The pitch is taken. That's a strike, and Cedeno with a stolen base. And again, the payoff. Andreessen bounces to Sachs, and he leaves his feet, throwing, and not trying. Well, Danny Andreessen hustling down the line, and he beats the play, and Steve Sachs really caught in between. He either Gamble charged the ball to come up with it, he lay back on it, and Steve Sachs chose to lay back, and that cost him. Well, Andreessen, an infield single. Cedeno moves to third, and Nick Ososki to the plate. Boy, he sets and delivers. That's inside, gets off the glove of Thimple. He can't find the handle, and the Reds have tied it up. Cedeno breaking right away, and he scored. A lot of pitches get away from Jack Thimple, and we'll see how they score that. The charge Thimple with a pass ball. They tie it up.
Well, that's how the Reds tied the score at 3-3 after three innings. And after the passed ball, there was the infield hit by Ososki and then a strikeout and a fly ball to end the inning. So two runs and three hits in that frame. In the top of the fourth inning, Puleo gets him in order. For the second straight time, Billy Russell a fly ball to left, Jack Thimple struck out swinging, and Jerry Royce hit a tapper back to the pitcher, Puleo on to Andreessen. And that was seven straight outs for Charlie. In the bottom of the fourth inning, the Reds have a chance to move ahead here, a golden opportunity, you might say, as once again, Jerry Royce walks back-to-back batters to force the bases loaded. He doesn't force in a run. We wish that Andreessen would have received one of his many walks that he gets each season, and as he was up here with the bases loaded, but he had a ground ball to third base to end this inning. And it's interesting to look back and see that in the first inning, the Reds had the bases loaded with back-to-back walks to Andreessen and Ososki, both on 3-2 pitches and with two out. And the same thing here in the fourth, on 3-2 pitches to Concepcion and Cedeno. He missed with each of them for ball four. To start off the inning, Puleo had a ground ball to first base, and then Milner had a double to right field. And for Milner, that is a club-leading 19th two-base hit to break out of a tie with Davey Concepcion. A one-out double to right for Milner, and then a strikeout swinging of Gary Reedus. Two men out, and then there's a wild pitch delivered by Royce. That gets Milner to third. Then Concepcion walked on the payoff pitch, and so did Cedeno. Bases loaded for Andreessen. He hits a ground ball to third baseman Guerrero. He ran over and touched third to force out Concepcion to end the inning. No runs, a hit, and three men left on, and the Reds have stranded five in the last two innings and have left eight on in four innings and have three runs and six hits through those four innings, so a rough time of it through four for Jerry Royce, but still, he is tied up at 3-3. In the top half of the fifth inning, there is a leadoff base runner here on a base on balls to Steve Sachs. That was on four pitches, third time that's happened. But then he is caught stealing on a peg from Bilardello to Concepcion. That's the 20th time he's been nailed. He leads the team in steals. He's 35 out of 55 in stolen bases now. Only 1-for-5 against the Reds in that department. So he's wiped off, and then Rick Mundy struck out swinging on a payoff pitch, and Ken Landreau came up with a double to right center field. And that caught stealing turns out to be a big one. Otherwise, they'd have gone ahead, but it was a nobody on double, so he's at second base with two down for Guerrero, and he flied out to center fielder Milner. No runs, one hit, no errors, one runner left on. In the bottom of the fifth, those same totals for the Reds. This is the final inning for Jerry Royce. A leadoff single to center field by Nick Osaski. He's forced out on a 5-4 ground ball hit by Ronnie Oster. Then Bill Ardello hit a little chopper in front of the plate. Fimple pounced on it, threw on to first. They got Bill Ardello 2-3. Oster went to second, was left there as pitcher Puleo struck out Swaining. No runs, a hit, one left on. In the top of the sixth in this tight 3-3 battle, it's the third time in the last four innings Puleo has retired them 1-2-3. He got Greg Brock on a leadoff line drive to the first baseman Dreesen. Then Marshall hit a ground ball to shortstop, and Billy Russell struck out Swaining, and he got him on three straight pitches, and Russell lost his bat on that last swing as he was fooled badly on the Puleo change of pace pitch. No runs, no hits, nobody left, and four straight retired by Charlie. And now we go to the bottom half of the sixth inning. It's a new pitcher, right-hander Tom Niedenfuhr. What a job he did. He retired every batter except one in the four innings that he worked, and he struck out seven, and those seven strikeouts came in a nine-batter period, starting with Concepcion, the number three hitter, and going through the number two batter, Reedus, who came up in the ninth inning. There were seven strikeouts in those nine batters. Now, the only two batters that did not strike out, Dreesen with a fly ball in the seventh, and a pinch-hit single for Dwayne Walker in the eighth inning. So all the outs but one were strikeouts from Concepcion out in the sixth through Reedus in the ninth inning. So a fine display of power pitching by second-year man Niedenfuhr. In the sixth inning, you got him in order. Milner, a foul pop to third. Reedus, a fly ball to left, and Concepcion was called out on strikes. Davey takes a lot of third strikes and has in this, rather bleak season for him, a batting average which has hovered just around the 235 mark all year, and came out of it with a brief hot spell. In fact, he had a 12-game hitting streak, which I believe was tops on the team this season, but since that time has gone into somewhat of a mild slump. In the sixth inning for the Reds, nothing across. In the top of the seventh, the Dodgers get a big run. This turns out to win the game, and this is against Charlie Puleo, and he is lifted after one man is out in this inning. Leadoff batter's Jack Fimple in this frame. He hits a fly ball to center field, and then Dave Anderson, who came on to play shortstop and bat ninth when Niedenfuhr came on to pitch in the sixth inning. Tom, the pitcher, batting in the seventh position as Lasorda made a double switch. Anderson comes up with a base hit, a single into right field. He later scores. And Steve Sachs on a hit and run as a perfect base hit into right field, perfectly placed single. That gets Anderson to third, and then Mundy draws a base on balls. Another walk, sixth of the game, given up by Puleo. That loads the bases full of Dodgers, and out comes manager Russ Nixon, and Puleo is relieved by left-hander Billy Shear. Shear did a good job here. He threw only two pitches and got two fly balls to right field, but unfortunately, one of those flies was only one out and was deep enough to get a run in. Landreau on the first pitch had a fly ball to deep right. Cedeno making the catch, but he could not keep Speedy Anderson from scoring a run that gave the Dodgers the lead at 4-3. And Landreau gets a run batted in, one that was his 47th of the year and his 11th game-winning RBI of the season. Then on the very next pitch, Guerrero ends the inning with an opposite field fly ball to right fielder Cedeno. They get a run on two hits, a sac fly, no errors, and two runners are left on base. In the bottom of the seventh inning against Niedenfuhr, down in order again. Six straight for Tom and three on strikeouts, two called. He got Cedeno on a called third K, and then Dreesen a fly ball to center. Then Osaski a strike out Swaining. And Osaski, a pretty good day. I thought he might go through the whole day without striking out, but that did not happen. He fans at least once a game. A walk, an infield hit, a single to center in the fifth, and now the strikeout Swaining to close out his day. And boy, that Niedenfuhr was just too tough for any of the Reds hitters. He struck out all but two. Well, I guess he did. He struck out seven, and there were seven different batters, including Johnny Bench, who came up as a pinch hitter in a key situation in the eighth inning, and he went down on strikes. So he got Concepcion, he got Cedeno, didn't get Dreesen, but did fan Osaski and Oster and Bench and Milner and Reedus. The final two batters did not strike out. If he'd have fanned them all in the ninth inning, that would have been quite a spectacular accomplishment. He would have fanned nine in four innings. How often do you see that? As it is, seven in four innings is miraculous enough. He was throwing BBs up there. So in the seventh, we've got nothing across, and that is, that's a total overall of nine straight batters retired by Royce and Niedenfuhr. In the eighth inning for the Dodgers, they're out 1-2-3. Only full inning of work for Shear. He gets all five that he faces. Good job by him. Brock went down swinging, strike three. Marshall, a ground ball to first baseman Dreesen. And then Niedenfuhr coming up to bat for himself. The way he's pitching, he doesn't need to come down for a pinch hitter. In the number seven position, Tom, it's a foul fly to right. A running catch in the Reds' bullpen made by Cesar Cedeno. No runs, no hits. In the bottom half of the eighth inning, well, Oster goes down swinging. Third time in four at-bats he is fanned. Then there's a pinch hitter for Bill Ardello. Lefty swinging reserve outfielder, Dwayne Walker. And he has the most pinch hits on the team. He gets another one here, a first pitch single into right field. That's his 11th pinch hit already this season. By the way, that is as many as any Reds pinch hitter had last year. That was Tops. 11 for 35 last year for Rafael Landestoy, now with that Dodger team, traded on May the 8th in that deal for Johnny Franco and Brett Wise. And Franco's done a good job for those Indians, who have won 14 of the last 15 in 8 or 9 consecutive games now. Soon to be not the AAA for the Reds in Indianapolis, but it's going to have a different AAA team for the Reds next year. And Walker has now tied Landestoy, and that is for the most pinch hits over the last couple of seasons. That was a 314 average for Rafael as a pinch hitter last year, and the 11th pinch hit for Walker comes, well, in five fewer at-bats than Landestoy had all of last season. 11 for 30 now as a pinch hitter for Walker with eight RBIs. Four of those 11 hits are doubles, two walks, and a sacrifice fly. And that's a 367 pinch average for Dwayne Walker, so he has done it consistently this season off that bench. 11 pinch hits. And this is a one-out first pitch single to right, and then he steals a base. He moves into scoring position as Johnny Bench was going down swinging on a 3-2 pitch. Walker pilfered his fourth base of the season in attempt number six. He's at second with two out for Eddie Milner. He goes down swinging on three pitches. He just blew him away with that last one. So a striking out of the side here, and the last four outs have been on K's. Would you believe that six of the last seven outs for Niedenfuhr have been on strikeouts? Back to that Concepcion K to end the sixth. In the eighth inning, no runs, a hit, a steal, no errors, one runner left on Walker's left at second base. In the top of the ninth inning, a new pitcher for the Reds, third used, right-hander Ben Hayes. And he comes on and does a good job. He gets him in order. In all, the Reds' relief pitchers were perfect in this game. Every batter was retired. Unfortunately, the one ball was deep enough to get that run in, as I mentioned, but still, it's not Shearer's fault. He got the fly. He got it out anyway. Although I don't know if he was trying for the ground ball, he might have gotten it up in the strike zone more than he wanted to Landro. But anyway, there were eight straight batters retired by Shearer and Hayes. Thimple was called out on strikes. He tied him in knots. That was a three-pitch strikeout. Then on the first pitch to David Anderson, he had a fly ball to right. And Steve Sachs did the same thing, a sky ball to the other way, right fielder. No runs, no hits, nobody left on. In the bottom of the ninth inning, it's a 1-2-3 inning, and it took a little longer than normal because we had some fisticuffs on the field, or a near fight anyway. It wasn't much, really. There's a lot of milling around. Gary Reedus struck out swinging. Then Dave Concepcion, after taking a high and inside pitch from the hard-throwing Niedenfuhr, later hit a fly ball to right fielder, which is newcomer Daryl Thomas, who has entered the game late. Then apparently on the way back toward the dugout, well, he didn't want to go back to the dugout immediately. He turned and walked in toward the mound, and the dugouts spilled onto the field. And someone restrained Concepcion before he got near Niedenfuhr, who is a big fella. And Davey was not able to throw any punches or lay any abuse on the Dodgers pitcher. Nobody was ejected for Cincinnati, but the Dodger manager, Tom Lasorda, as I mentioned, was thrown out of the game. And I don't know what he was so hot about. Apparently he wanted Concepcion pitched out or something. But he was right up in the face of Jerry Crawford, and he was thumbed by the home plate umpire. So Lasorda ejected, and he had a few more insults to lay on the home plate umpire before he departed third base side. And of course, it wasn't really too damaging for Lasorda. Only one out to go in the game. He only missed a couple of pitches and was probably down there in the well in the third base dugout watching that final pitch. As Cedeno hit a game-ending fly ball to left field a few minutes later. We got back to playing after both benches cleared, and everybody went back to the bench after the mild altercation. A fly ball to left by Cedeno, pulled down fairly deep in there by Rick Mundy. The veteran made the catch, and that was the ball game. What a fine job by Niedenfuhr as he gets just about everybody that he faces. The only man to reach was the pinch hitter Walker in the eighth inning. No runs, no hits, no one left on base in the ninth for Cincinnati. In that final, the Dodgers 4 and the Reds 3. Los Angeles now has a one-run record of 22 wins and 15 losses. And I think that would be just barely better than Cincinnati's percentage, where the Reds dropped to 20-13, still 7 over. The Reds entering this game had the best percentage in one-run games in the National League. But now we're 2 wins behind L.A., but still 2 up in the loss column also in that one-run category. The Reds have been just amazing, especially lately, in one-run decisions. It might be something like 8 of the last 10 the Reds have won in that category. The Reds are now 25-31 in road games and 2-1 on this homestand. We were trying for the sweep over the Dodgers. That would have been something. I'd like to know the last time that happened. The Reds sweeping L.A. probably back in the, well, in the glory days of the 70s. We did it a few times. I think the Reds exchanged sweeps, a four-game series, if I recall correctly, a few years back. And that was way early in the season, back in April of 1975, I think it might have been, a four-game series sweep for the Reds, and then the Dodgers returned the favor. But this series ends up in Cincinnati's column, I guess. 2 wins for the Reds, 1 win for the Dodgers. And the Reds have now won still 3 of the last 4 games. The Reds against the West are now 24-36. They're 28-27 against the East. We're 41-44 against right-handers. And so far for the month of August, still 1 over at 6-5 and now 18-16 since the All-Star game. And 35-44 on AstroTurf so far this season. And the Reds have gone 33-45 in night games this year. The Reds' team batting average stayed the same. It's at .242 with 916 hits. And the Reds have a .358 slugging average with a .397 team earned run average. Over the last 22 games, the ERA is a very good 3.60. 78 earned runs and 195 innings pitched. The Reds had a string of 3 straight complete games stopped when Paleo was relieved by Shear in the 7th inning tonight. The Reds have now had 24 complete games. Soto leads the majors with 13. And, of course, he leads the Reds in wins with 13. And Joe Price, who is now on the disabled list, he has 10 victories. Price was placed on the Reds' 21-day disabled list a few days back on Monday, August the 8th, the off day before this series. Price on the 21-day disabled list because of a sore left shoulder that bothered him in his last start, which was Game 2 of the Saturday, August 6th doubleheader at San Diego. He only went 2 1/3 innings in that ball game, got a no decision. He's 10-6 on the year, having won 5 of his last 6 decisions. He was Pitcher of the Month for July with a 5-1 record and a 1.98 ERA for 6 games, giving up just 9 runs all of last month. So Price is now shelved, and the Reds have recalled right-handed 21-year-old pitcher Jeff Russell from their AAA farm club at Indianapolis to take Price's place on the roster. Let's see what Russell has done this season. Well, he comes up with a league-leading ERA in the American Association of 3.55. He got that down a few more points in his final game at AAA, which was on August the 7th at Oklahoma City. He pitched Indianapolis to another victory. They've been playing outstandingly well. And great pitching also, which is a turnaround from previous months. In that game on the 7th at Oklahoma City, Russell went 8 innings, allowed just 2 runs and 1 earned, and Keith Cato came on to pitch the final inning and get his first save. Cato, of course, was up earlier in June and picked up a victory in one decision with a .245 ERA in 4 games for the Reds. So Jeff Russell, his first major league call-up. He was born on September 2nd, 1961 at Cincinnati. He's from Wyoming High School, came out of Wyoming High School in Cincinnati and still resides in the Queen City, so a homegrown product there. 21 years old, almost 22. Bats right, throws right. He's 6 feet 4 inches tall and tips the scales at 200 pounds. Last season at Waterbury did a fine job, although he was only in 14 games. He might have been hurt part of the year. He made 12 starts with 2 complete games, one of those a shutout, and he struck out 88 batters in just 79 and 2/3 innings en route to a 6-4 slate and a 2.37 earned run average at the Reds' AA at Waterbury in the Eastern League in 82. So Jeff Russell up, and he's going to make his first major league appearance on Saturday during this homestand against the Padres. This upcoming Saturday night, a 7:05 game, he'll hook up with John Monofusco of the Padres that particular evening. Just 2 days from now, and I'm sure Russell getting excited about his first Major League game, and right in his hometown, too. He'll no doubt have a lot of support at Riverfront Stadium as he takes the place of Joe Price in the Reds starting rotation. He had a 5-5 record, evening out his record with that win at Oklahoma City the other night. That good ERA of 3.55, still, that's not that really that great, but for that league, that is pretty good, and that did lead the league at the time he was brought up. So Price is going to be out for at least 3 weeks because of the shoulder problems. He has a 2.77 ERA, a 10-6 record, and 80 strikeouts to his credit. The Reds have had 3 shutouts this year, 20 saves, 307 appearances by pitchers, and the Reds have hit 76 home runs and have driven in 402 runs with 167 doubles and 23 triples. Reds have only had 1 triple since the 23rd of July, and that was a 3-bagger by Eddie Milner the other day, his 4th of the year, to tie him with Osterhausholder and Ritas for club lead. The Reds have scored 430 runs this year so far on this homestand. The Reds have tallied 17 times. That's almost 6 per game. They've had a home run with 30 base hits and a .291 batting average for these last 3 games and a respectable .333 team ERA for 27 innings, allowing just 10 runs and 3 home runs. The Reds have now turned 88 double plays and 4 so far in this series, or, well, 4 in this series concluded and 4 on the homestand. The Reds have not committed an error in the last 3 games. And so that's a look at some of the statistics for the Cincinnati Reds right up to date. The Reds are now 7-7 against the Dodgers now, 4-3 at Cincinnati and 3-4 at Los Angeles. The Reds had a 3-game winning streak against the Dodgers stopped tonight, as well as an overall 3-game winning streak come to an end. The Dodgers have the best team earned run average in the major leagues, 3.05. That's going to go down again. They only gave up 2 earned runs in this game. That'll go down probably to around 302 to 303, by far the best in baseball. And now we'll go to the final statistics pages for this ballgame on the 11th of August. The visiting Los Angeles Dodgers used 12 players in this game, a couple of pitchers included. This is LA's 112th game of the season. They played 3 fewer than Cincinnati. The record for the Dodgers is now 62-50. 12 games above .500 for a .554 winning percentage. They remain 6.5 games back in second place in the West Division. Number 3 is Steve Sax, and he led off for the Dodgers tonight at second base. He was 1-for-4. Batting second in left field, Rick Mundy, a veteran of several Major League seasons, former Oakland A and Chicago Cub, became a Dodger in January of 77 and has been there ever since. Number 16, Rick Mundy, left field, 0-for-2. And he did walk a couple of times, struck out and grounded out, and he got the game-ending putout in left field. Hitting third and center field is Ken Landreau, number 44. He was 1-for-2 with a double, a run scored, a run batted in, the game winner. Batting fourth at third base, Pedro Guerrero, number 28. And Pete tonight was 0-for-3, but he did score a run, walked once. Hitting fifth at first base is Greg Brock. Number 9, he had the big hit. He knocked in 3/4 of their runs with that home run in the first inning. Overall, 1-for-4 with a run scored, 3 knocked in. Hitting 6th in right field is Mike Marshall, number 5. And Mike tonight, he wore a size 4 collar. He grounded out twice and struck out his first 2 times, so 0-for-4 for Mike. Also batting 6th, the late entry, Daryl Thomas, right field, number 30, 1 put out, no at-bats. And nothing across the line for him. Batting 7th at shortstop, Bill Russell, number 18. 1 hit, 3 at-bats, and 1 error. Also in the number 7 position, pitcher Tom Niedenfuhr. He was 0-for-1. He had a foul fly to end the 8th inning against Billy Shear. Batting in the 8th position, the catcher Jack Fimple, number 31. He was 0-for-3. And batting 9th, pitcher Jerry Royce, 0-for-1 with a sacrifice. And number 10, Dave Anderson at shortstop. He was 1-for-2 and scored the winning run in the 7th inning. The Dodgers had 29 official at-bats with 5 hits, 4 runs, 4 runs batted in, and 1 error. For Cincinnati, a total of 14 players used, including 3 hurlers, in this game number 115 for the homestanding club. The record is now 11-500 for the Reds, a .452 percentage at 52 wins, 63 losses. The Reds are now 18 games back, losing a game, of course, in last place in the West, but just 2.5 games behind those fifth place San Francisco Giants. Number 20, Eddie Milner in center field led off. He was 1-for-5. He had a 2-base hit to give him 19 of those on the season. His batting average stayed where it was at game time, even though he batted only 200 in this game, still batting 272 for the year with a 4-game hitting streak. He's also hit safely in all but one of his last 10 games. He's had 104 hits, second on the team. His slugging average is now at 397. That stayed the same. Batting second in left field, Gary Reedus, number 2. He was 1-for-5 on the day and scored 2 runs. Gary is now batting at 241, down a point, 75 hits, a 434 slugging average for Gary. Hitting third at shortstop is Dave Concepcion, number 13. 0-for-3 for Davey with 1 RBI, a sac fly for him. He's now down to 235. 92 hits, 392 at-bats. He has hit safely in 7 of his last 10 and 17 of his last 21 games. Batting 4th in right field is Cesar Cedeño, number 28. He had 2 base hits, 4 at-bats, 1 run scored, 1 RBI. And Cedeño's average is up a couple of points, or 4 points, to 234. He's hit safely in 9 of 11 and 15 of his last 21. He's had exactly 100 total bases so far this year. 65 hits, a slugging average, which went up to 360 from 354 tonight. Hitting in the 5 position at first base, Danny Dreesen, number 22. And Danny was 1-for-3 in this game. And he's got a 6-game hitting streak, longest currently on the team, tied with Nick Osaski. And Dreesen is batting a club-high 294, hiked that one more point tonight. 120 total bases, 77 base hits for him. A slugging average of 458, second on the team, down a notch. Batting 6th at third base is Nick Osaski, number 12. 2 hits and 3 at-bats, plus a walk for Nick. So he had a pretty good day. And on the season, his average goes up some 7 notches. He's at 278 right now. That is 2nd on the team. A 6-game hitting streak, 87 total bases, exactly 50 hits now for him in his first 180 Major League at-bats, and a club-high slugging average that went up 3 points to 483. Hitting 7th at 2nd base is Ronnie Oster. He's number 16. He was 0-for-4, a bad day for him, a fielder's choice, and 3 strikeouts. He's down to 269, down 3 points. He's at 111 hits to top the squad and leads in at-bats, 4-1-2. He's hit safely in 6 of his last 9, slugging average 391. Batting 8th is the catcher Dan Belardello, number 9, 0-for-3. Danny batting 232, down a few points, 4 out of his last 6 he's hit safely in, and 8 of his last 11 he's had 47 hits this season. And his slugging average is 355. Hitting 8th, a pinch hitter, Dwayne Walker, number 26. He was 1-for-1, his average up 5 points to 260. He's hit safely in 11 of his last 18 games. That's a pretty good stat in there, only 7 games he has not hit in his last 18, and that includes mostly pinch hitting roles, so that's even more impressive. 38 hits now for Walker, 11 of those as a pinch hitter, a slugging average for him of 390. And also in the 8th position, a late entry catcher, Alex Trevino, number 29, no at bat for him. And Trevino batting a miserable 194 on the season. Batting 9th, pitcher Charlie Puleo, 0-for-3, he's now hitting 088, 3 out of 34. And also pitcher Billy Shear, no time up. Pinch hitter Johnny Bench, number 5. A standing ovation, as usual, when he is announced. And Johnny 0-for-1 with a strikeout in this game. He's now batting at 246, 66 hits, 107 total bases, slugging average from 401. At game time, it drops now to 399. And also batting 9th, Ben Hayes, pitcher, no time up. The Reds had 35 at-bats, 3 runs, 2 RBIs, 8 base hits, with no errors. Now some pitching lines for the Dodgers. Left-hander Jerry Royce, number 41, the starter, a no decision. He remained 6-10 on the year. He went 5 innings, allowed 7 base hits, 3 runs, 2 of them earned, no homers issued. He walked 4, and he struck out 6 batters. The Reds struck out 13 times tonight. In 9 innings, the Dodgers allowed just 8 hits and 3 runs, 2 earned, with 4 walks, and the big 13 strikeouts. In 1 less inning, Niedenfuhr struck out 1 more batter than Royce, so he was impressive. I got Royce's numbers here for the season. This was his 22nd appearance and start of the year, and his first in some 12 days. 2 complete games, neither has been a whitewashing. He's had no saves and has given up a dozen gopher balls. Six wins at a 3.36 ERA. That's exactly 3.36. Nothing left over on the end at all. That's up 0.01. In 150 innings even, he's allowed a high total of hits, 171. 56 earned runs. He's walked only 34. That's just a shade over 2 per 9 innings. He has struck out 97. Against the Reds this season, he has a record of 0-1 in two games with a 2.70 earned run average. Going back and looking at a game he pitched against the Reds, not doing too badly, but losing a 3-2 decision at Riverfront on June the 10th, going 5-plus frames, allowing 7 hits, no home runs, 3 runs, only 1 earned. He walked 4 and struck out 4 in that game. So in 2 starts against the Reds, he's gone 10-plus innings, allowing 6 runs, only 3 earned on 14 hits, without a home run, 8 walks, and 10 strikeouts. Lifetime against Cincinnati, 19 wins, 17 losses. By the way, I checked up on Royce's records, and those 19 wins are the most that he's had against any individual National League ball club in his career. Was looking for win number 20 tonight against Cincinnati. He's had great success against the Reds back to 1980. In 80, he was one of only two pitchers, he and Joe Niekro, to win 4 games against the Reds, and I think those were the only two pitchers to win more than 2 against the Reds in 1980, when the Reds won 89 times. He was 4-1, Royce was, against Cincinnati, having a 4-game personal winning streak against Cincinnati stopped on September the 19th of that 80 season, when Johnny Bench hit a big grand slam off of him to left field in a 7-run second inning to knock Royce out early, and a rare off-outing for him. In 81, in the split season, Royce was 1-0 against us, and last year was 3-2 against the Reds, including a magnificent one-hitter in an 11-1 Dodger win on June the 11th at Dodger Stadium. A complete game, only one run given up with no walks and 7 strikeouts, and he retired 27 straight batters after Eddie Milner opened the game with a double, moved to third on a sacrifice, and scored on a ground ball. So he did not get the shutout, but still a near-perfect game for Jerry Royce, and he said that's the best game he's ever pitched in the major leagues, combining his days with the Cardinals and the Houston Astros and the Pittsburgh Pirates, and he's been a Dodger since April of 1979 when the Dodgers got him for Rick Rodin, I should say, in a 1-for-1 deal just after that 79 season started. He said that one-hitter against the Reds, he said he even had better stuff that day than he did in his no-hitter, his only no-hitter that he pitched in 1980 on June 27th at Candlestick against the Giants. So those are the numbers on Jerry Royce. Veteran left-hander. Number 49 is Tom Niedenfuhr, and he gets the victory. He's 6-1 now. That one loss, by the way, was against the Reds a week ago tonight. He went 4 innings in this game, allowed just 1 hit, no runs of any kind, no walks, and the big 7 strikeouts. I should also mention Royce tossed a wild pitch in addition to 7 hits and 5 innings. Tom Niedenfuhr, the winner. That is Niedenfuhr. A long last name there. I got some numbers on him also. This was his 45th appearance of the season, all in relief. Now 6-1 with 5 saves and a 1.53 ERA. That fell 10 notches tonight. In 64 and two-thirds innings, he's allowed only 32 base hits, 11 earned runs, with only 15 walks and 50 strikeouts. He's averaging 6.96 strikeouts per 9 innings and only 2.09 walks every 9 innings, winning percentage of .857. So quite a year shaping up for this second-year right-hander, Tom Niedenfuhr. And as I mentioned, his only loss coming against Cincinnati in an extra-inning Reds win at Dodger Stadium. And now for the Cincinnati pitching lines, right-hander Charlie Puleo gets the start, and he loses it. He's now 4-8 on the year. He's number 25. He went 6 1/3 innings in this game, allowed 5 hits, and one of those a home run, 4 runs all earned. He walked 6 and struck out 5, so again, control eluded him again tonight. He's now walked 70 batters in 101 and 2/3 innings. That covers 19 appearances, 16 of those starts, with no complete games, no saves, 13 home runs given up. He's allowed 96 hits, 56 runs, 51 earned, with 57 strikeouts and an ERA of 4.51. Against the Los Angeles Dodgers in his career, this was his first loss suffered. And that dates back to, I guess, late 81 when he was recalled by the Mets from AAA Tidewater. This season, he's 1-1 against the Dodgers, lifetime 2-1, last year 1-0 as a Met. On June 10th at Cincinnati, when he was matched up with Jerry Royce, Puleo came out on top in an excellently pitched ball game, a 3-2 final score. 6 2/3 innings Charlie went, allowed just 1 run, 7 hits, 5 walks, 2 strikeouts, no home runs, and a hit batsman. Then on August the 1st at Dodger Stadium, Charlie had a no decision in a 4-2 Cincinnati 10-inning victory, going six innings, allowing seven hits, two runs, both earned, with two walks, six strikeouts, and a home run given up. So in three games against the Dodgers in 19 innings, he has a 3.32 ERA, giving up 19 hits and seven runs, all earned, with two homers, 13 walks, 13 strikeouts, and a hit batsman. And next is Billy Shear, number 34, lefty, went 1 2/3 innings, a perfect ball, no hits or runs, no walks, one strikeout. Shear has been in the most games of any Reds pitcher, 51 now, all in relief. He has eight saves to top the team. He's 1-3 with a 3.32 ERA. He's allowed 25 runs, two of those unearned, in 62 1/3 innings, four homers, 48 hits, 25 walks, and 40 strikeouts. Number 45, Ben Hayes, took over in the ninth inning, and one strikeout, nothing else for Ben. This was his 44th appearance, all out of the bullpen. He has four saves, three wins, two losses, and a 5.98 ERA. Started out the day at 6.10. 52 2/3 innings, 68 hits, 38 runs, 35 earned, 5 gopher balls, 27 walks, and 36 strikeouts this year for Ben Hayes, who was the top pitcher on the team last year, earned run average-wise, at 1.97 for, I think, 26 appearances last year. Hopefully he'll get his act together the rest of this season so the Reds can make a charge for that fifth-place position. And now a categorized summary of some of the statistics. There were doubles by Landro, Cedeno, and Milner. No triples. Home run, Greg Brock is 15th. Game-winning RBI, 11th of the year for Kenny Landro. Stolen bases, there were three of those, and the Reds were 3 out of 3, Dodgers 0 for 1. Steve Sachs was nail-stealing, and the Reds had Reedus, Cedeno, and Walker perfect in each try. The Reds have now stolen 101 bases and have been caught just 48 times this year, with Reedus and Milner setting the way. Sacrifice bunt, Royce. Sacrifice fly, Landro and Concepcio. No double plays in the game. A wild pitch by Royce and a passed ball charged against Jack Fimple. There was one pinch hit in the ballgame by the Reds' Dwayne Walker. That was the 15th pinch hit for the Reds in the last 39 at-bats. That's a .385 average going back to July the 11th. Overall, they're hitting a very good .247 as pinch hitters, 36 of 146, with a .377 slugging average as pinch hitters with 10 doubles and 3 home runs. The winning pitcher tonight, Niedenfuhr, 6-1, loser Paleo, 4-8. The Dodgers had 4 runs on but 5 hits with 1 error by Billy Russell, 6 men left on. The Reds left 10 men on base, 3 runs, 8 hits, and no errors. The game time, 2 hours 52 minutes, and my clocking was also 2:52. The paid and the total attendance tonight, 14,069. Would you believe someone up in the press box tonight guessed that attendance figure exactly right? They have a contest going on up there to see who can come closest to the attendance figures, I guess, and someone guessed it exactly correct. And it got a standing ovation from the people up there in the press box. The Reds now have drawn 842,694 customers paid into Riverfront Stadium for 54 dates. That's an average of 15,605, and keep in mind that is according to box score reports. That is not official. And so that's a look at this bowl game. Dodgers winning over the Reds by the final of 4-3. And now it's time to take a look at the standings through games of August the 11th. We'll have a look now at the divisional leaders. In the American League East, it's the Milwaukee Brewers now in first place by just a half game over the Yankees. Four clubs in that division are separated by just one game, as the Orioles are just one back and the Tigers just one behind. So still tighter than anything in that AL East. In the AL West, it's the White Sox on top by a fairly comfortable margin of 6 over Kansas City. In the NL East, it's Philadelphia in first place by 1 over Montreal. In the West, the Braves lead by 6.5 over the Dodgers. Well, limited action in Major League Baseball today and tonight. There was one rained-out ball game in the American League, Kansas City at Boston. Four AL games to pass along, and I've got three other National League scores to read off. First of all, in the National League, the Braves with 3 in the first coasted from there and went on to beat the San Francisco Giants 6-4. Home runs, Dale Murphy had 2. He's got 25 now. Jack Clark had his 16th. They had 31,214 at Atlanta. And it was the Houston Astros winning over the San Diego Padres at the Astrodome in front of 15,120, a 5-1 final score, as Mike Scott got a victory. And it was the St. Louis Cardinals dropping another one. They've lost 10 of 11. The Cubs beat them 10-5 at Wrigley Field this afternoon. Leon Durham had a game-winning grand slam home run, his 11th home run of the season. The Cubs scored all of their runs in 2 innings, 4 in the third, and then 6 more in the 4th inning. That put it away. The Cardinals continue to slump off. Ozzie Smith was 4-for-5 in that game for the losing team. Danny Cox, the loser, in his second major league start for the Cardinals. Only went 3 1/3. He's 0-1. Dick Ruthven gets his eighth win. 23,480 at Chicago. A St. Louis home run. Dave Van Slyke, a rookie, his sixth of the season. In the American League, it was the White Sox behind the good pitching of Floyd Bannister, beating the Baltimore Orioles 9-3, a 6-run third inning for Chicago. Bannister is now 10-9 for his new White Sox team. Done a good job of late. He struck out 11 and 6 in the third. They had 31,810 at Chicago. The A's shut out the Twins 6-0, a complete game 5-hit shutout for Chris Cotteroli. He's 9-8. Struck out only one, but walked only one. Frank Viola takes the loss, 6,915 at Oakland. It was the Brewers over the Toronto Blue Jays as the Brew Crew goes into first place by a half game, a 6-4 final. A home run for sizzling hot Milwaukee first baseman Cecil Cooper, his 25th of the year. Chuck Porter got his fifth win. Doyle Alexander, 0-7, the loser for Toronto. Why in the world they picked him up? Well, we'll never know, but he's a starting pitcher, went 4 1/3. I think he was 0-7 last year for the Yankees. 27,621 at Toronto. And in 10 innings, the Yankees beat the Tigers 6-5. An 18th game-winning RBI of the year, can you believe it, for Dave Winfield, having a super season. 2-for-5 today, a solo home run, his 23rd homer of the year. The winner was Rich Gossage. He's now 10-3, the reliever. Struck out 4 3 1/3. Ray Fontenot was the starter. Loser, Howard Bailey's 5-5. 36,582 at Detroit. And the Yankees will have to complete that suspended game with Kansas City that was stopped on July the 24th. Actually, it looked like it was completed when George Brett hit that home run. But there was the pine tar incident. And that's going to be picked up on August the 18th, a week from tonight at 6 p.m., and WLW is going to carry it. As Rich Gossage gave up the home run to George Brett, it sparked all kinds of controversy as the pine tar apparently was too high on the bat. They nullified the homer and now gave it back to him. They're going to complete that game next Thursday. We notice Indianapolis comes up with another victory. It's ninth in a row, and it's 12th in its last 13 games. A 3-1 win over Evansville behind Greg Harris, the former Red. His eighth win and a 5-hit, 11-strikeout performance. Again, the final from Riverfront Stadium tonight. It was the Los Angeles Dodgers 4 and the Reds 3 in 2 hours 52 minutes in front of 14,069. Until next time, so long. ¶¶